Welcome back to the Growth Marriage Podcast. On today's episode, we are going to be talking about quarantine. It's something that we're all dealing with right now. It's causing a lot of stress and putting some pressure on our marriages. And so I want to talk to you about how you can deal with quarantine in the very best way possible. Stay tuned. Quarantine is on everybody's minds right now. You know, we're all scared of COVID-19. There's a lot of crazy things happening in the world right now. The news is nonstop about this disease and people are staying home. And I don't know, I just noticed that there's just a lot more tension in the air. I opened up my website earlier today, and there's a section on my website. If you just go to growthmarriage.com/ask, you can ask me questions. And a lot of times I'll go through those questions to pick out what topics I want to cover for podcast episodes. And today I logged on and there were just a whole bunch of questions of people saying that being in quarantine with their partner is causing problems in their relationship. It's causing pressure, it's causing stress, it's causing anxiety, it's causing frustration, it's causing overwhelm. And oh my gosh, do I get that. I'm even experiencing it in my own marriage. I'm not used to being with my wife 24/7. And it can be hard. There's days where, you know, your mood is contagious, or if you're having a crappy day and it rubs off on your partner, that's no fun. Or, you know, it's easy to become judgmental. We could go into all of the problems that can be caused by quarantine, but I just want you to know that I feel it. I get it. Like, I'm not exempt from it either. And we're all feeling the crunch. And I've been thinking about this idea, feeling the crunch or feeling pressure right now. Over the last week, I've thought about it a lot. And I'm going to make an analogy. So sometimes I watch these YouTube channels. One is called the Slow Mo Guys, and the other one is called the Hydraulic Press Channel. And the Hydraulic Press Channel, they like put objects underneath a hydraulic press, and then they crush it and watch what happens if like you crush a bowling ball, or if you crush a coin, or if you crush a jawbreaker candy, and they crush all these different things. And the Slow Mo Guys film things happening in slow motion. And there's this one video that I really love where they fill up this giant balloon. It's as big as a trampoline, and they just fill it with water until it pops. Then they played back the explosions or the pop or the crushing in slow motion, so you can see what happens in slow motion, and it's really cool. And what I've noticed from watching way too many of those videos is that whenever something collapses or crushes or whenever something breaks down, it's typically because the pressure exposes a specific weakness in the object that's being crushed. So, you know, there was a video I watched earlier today that was a rubber band ball. It was this huge rubber band ball, and they put it under a hydraulic press, and it squished and squished and squished, and then all of a sudden, bink, one of the rubber bands popped, and then bing, 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 a couple more popped, and then right around the seam where the hydraulic press was pushing on the ball, a whole bunch of rubber bands started popping, and then it just imploded and exploded. It was crazy. And that one point where the hydraulic press hit the rubber band ball was the point of failure. It was the point of weakness. That was where the most pressure was. Same thing happened with the Slow Mo Guys in this balloon video that I watched, where they put this guy underneath the giant balloon, they filled it up with all the water, and then out of nowhere, you see this seam just split across the balloon and all the water just pours out. And it's super crazy. And I started to realize that pressure exposes weaknesses. They actually do things in, like, if you were NASA, or, you know, if you're building a rocket or you're building something that needs to be really, really safe, you pressure test that thing. You pump it full of air or pump it full of water or really high pressure to make sure that there's no leaks. Otherwise, it could ruin the entire mission or it could ruin the entire plan. And quarantine is like pressure testing your marriage. It's a really interesting idea. The things that are coming to the surface right now, the things that are becoming pain points for you in quarantine are actually opportunities for you to grow. They're opportunities for you to identify a weakness that needs to be strengthened. So a lot of the messages that I got this week were from people saying that, specifically it sounds like women saying that their husbands are home 24/7 now and they're not helpful, and the responsibilities of running the household have grown exponentially because maybe you have kids at home and there's all sorts of things happening, and maybe the wife's roles have changed and evolved and she's taken on more responsibility, and it seems like the husband is unwilling in a lot of these questions. And so I wanted to give you some ideas of things that you can do if you're in a situation like this, or if you're just feeling pressure in general, to make sure that your marriage stays strong and to make sure that you can survive quarantine. So the first thing that is really important to do, and my wife and I did this very early on with regards to quarantine, is you need to sit down and you need to remake agreements. So the way a marriage works is you work as a partnership. And a partnership, if you have a functional marriage, a partnership works where you each have specific responsibilities. You know, maybe you have a CFO who's in charge of the finances and a COO who's in charge of the operations. Maybe one person is in charge of outside chores and the other person's in charge of inside chores. Like, you might split up the duties in a million different ways. But the thing is that this needs to be a constant negotiation. You can't just like set up the roles and responsibilities and make these agreements on day one of your marriage and then never change them, because your life changes and therefore the agreements need to change. You know, you might have kids, or somebody might lose a job, or their health might change, or you might get stuck in quarantine. Whenever there's a change in circumstance, you need to change the agreement that you make with your partner with regards to who's in charge of what and why. So right now my wife is pregnant and we're in quarantine, and she's been really sick lately and she's really fatigued. And so there came a point where we realized, oh my gosh, this is causing a lot of stress and pressure in our marriage. We need to sit down and renegotiate and recreate our agreements as a couple so that we can make sure that our household functions normally. And I think a lot of people are becoming resentful of each other because they haven't sat down and just had the conversation. Hey, what are you in charge of now that all this has changed? Or have you noticed that we all now have these brand new responsibilities added into our relationship, or these new obstacles that are becoming a stressor in our relationship? And I'd like to have a plan with how we deal with that. So that's my first tip. Sit down and renegotiate your agreements with your partner to make sure that your household can run smoothly. The second thing that I would highly, highly recommend is that you make sure that you are taking time for yourself and that your partner's taking time for themselves. When you're cooped up in a house or an apartment 24/7, you're on top of each other. There's a lot of stress. There's a lot of pressure. There's a lot of things happening. It's good to take some time to yourself. This is a really important boundary to have. I feel like there's this really great quote by Esther Perel, and she says that in order to have a healthy marriage, you must meet opposing needs at the same time. That's the general idea of the quote. She talks about the need for novelty and also the need for stability, the need for like surprise and excitement, and yet a predictable, reliable, consistent life and having some routine. You need to have a sense of independence, and you need to have a sense of togetherness. And if you spend too much time on the togetherness time, like a lot of us are doing in quarantine, you start to feel smothered. You start to feel just overwhelmed, like it's just too much. And you need to balance it out by coming over here on this side of the pendulum and getting some alone time, some individual time. So whether that's identifying a room in your house that you go to every day where it's just your space and nobody can touch you, maybe you take a nice long bath every day, lock yourself in your bathroom. Maybe you go out for a 1-hour walk every day. Maybe you go down in the basement and you do some exercise by yourself, but make sure that you're getting some alone time so you can recharge your batteries and reconnect with your sense of self. If all you're doing all day is giving, 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 man, you're going to run out real quick. You're going to get burned out, and then you're going to be no good to anybody, including yourself and the people that you love. So please, please take time to yourself. It might seem like it's impossible. It might seem like it's a ridiculous thing to even think that you have time in your day to take to yourself. But I promise you, if you prioritize it as much as you prioritize some of the other things in your life, not only will it work a miracle in your life and refill your tank, but you'll find that the people around you, when you do take that time and you come back energized and refocused, they're going to want to defend that time for you because they want you to show up as your best self. So even talk to your partner and protect their alone time and have them protect your alone time. Create agreements with them with regards to how you're going to spend your alone time and when that's going to be and where it's going to take place, so that you can make sure that you have time to recharge your batteries and get in touch with that sense of self. And then when you do have that time, don't waste it. Don't sit there and scroll social media. Like, get out and do something. Go for a walk, listen to a podcast that's uplifting, exercise, do some push-ups, take a bath, meditate, do some yoga, do something that's going to recharge your batteries, not something that's going to make you feel as empty as you felt when you started it. The last thing that I want you to do is I want you to give yourself a break. This is a difficult time for everybody. You're stressed, you're overwhelmed, you got a lot going on. And you know what? It's okay if one night you say, you know what? I don't want to do dinner tonight. Everybody's having peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. That is totally okay. It's okay if your kids, if you're stressed out, teaching your kids their school lessons and trying to make sure that they stay on top of everything, it's okay to take your kids out of school. I did an interview. You can jump on my YouTube channel. I did an interview with this guy last week to talk about what you can do to help manage the schooling time right now with kids. I know a lot of parents are feeling a lot of pressure making sure that their kids are getting their homework done, and they have to play teacher for like sometimes multiple children at multiple age levels studying multiple different topics. And that on top of everything else you're already doing could be just like, it could break you. So take your kids out of school for the last month and a half of the year until summer hits and homeschool them so they don't have to follow the state mandated curriculum. That might be a really helpful move that could just give you your sanity back. You know, assess your life. What are the things that I'm doing that are necessary? And what are the stresses and pressures that I'm putting on myself? Because I have really high expectations for myself, and these are maybe unnecessary things that I'm doing. And if you could just give yourself a break, let yourself not be 100%, let yourself not be the perfect mom or the perfect dad or the perfect husband or the perfect wife, and just take a break, man, it can do a whole lot of good. Self-compassion is really important. I think the most intense arguments that I've gotten in with my wife is when my wife is being cruel and unkind to herself. I think there's a lot of people doing that right now. They're being cruel and impatient and unkind to themselves. And I wouldn't permit somebody else to talk to my wife the way that she talks to herself sometimes. So I want you to take a stand for yourself. If you wouldn't allow anybody else to talk to you that way, I don't want you to allow yourself to talk to you that way. If you would be ticked off if your mom or your sister or your friend or a stranger at the grocery store said the things to you that you say to yourself, then stop. It is time to stop and be kinder to yourself and be a little bit more compassionate. Take a deep breath and give yourself a break. I'm hoping that those three tips can help you kind of take a little bit of the pressure off of quarantine and use these opportunities, if there's tension in your marriage right now, to step back and think about what is causing the breakdown. There's pressure, obviously, but where's the weakness? Where's the weak point in our marriage that's causing us to not be able to contain this pressure and deal with it in a healthy way? And have those conversations. The three things that I talked about today are probably the things that are causing you the most stress. You don't have time to yourself. You haven't had conversations about the agreements of how you're taking care of things within your relationship, and you're being really hard on yourself. And those things are just magnified right now. They're things that are probably already present in your relationship, and because of the pressure, it's exposing those weaknesses, and this is an opportunity for you to work on those weaknesses. So please don't miss out on that opportunity. Please work on them, because when the pressure subsides, if you work to strengthen those areas, your relationship, when things go back to normal, is gonna be so much better because of it. So look at this as an opportunity and make sure that you take action on the things that are most important to ensure that your marriage can not only withstand quarantine, but thrive afterwards. I'm cheering for you guys, and I've got another episode coming out next week. I'm really excited to share it with you. Hang in there. We're in this together. If there's anything I can do to help, shoot me an email. My email is nate@growthmarriage.com. You know, whenever I have something really awesome coming up, I like to tell you all about it. I put a lot of time and effort into putting together really cool things to help you strengthen your marriage and make it amazing. And this thing that we have coming up is the most impactful, amazing thing that I've ever had the chance to be a part of. It's the Epic Wives Experiment. We are doing our third iteration of the Epic Wives Experiment starting on May 18th. I gotta tell you, we've had over 500 wives participate in the Epic Wives and Experiment, and it has been a life-changing experience for so many. We've had some wives that have showed up and said, hey, I thought my marriage was pretty great, and then I started doing this and I realized how much better it could get. I had no idea that I could do these little things to take my relationship from great to absolutely incredible. And then we've had other wives join who are in a bit of a hard spot. They're feeling a little overwhelmed. They're feeling stressed out. They're feeling burned out. They're feeling a little bit lonely, maybe even growing resentful of their partner. And they come in and they do these little experiments over the course of 4 weeks, and they walk away literally experiencing what I would call miracles. They go from feeling lonely to feeling connected. They go from feeling stressed out and burned out to feeling at peace and like they have more energy and enthusiasm for their relationship. They go from feeling disconnected to feeling massively connected and loved and cared for. And all of this happens a lot of the time without their husbands even knowing they're participating. So if you're a husband listening and you have a wife, obviously, I would love it if you would ask her to join. That would be amazing. And if you are a wife and you want to create a massive positive shift in your relationship, I want to invite you to join the Epic Wives Experiment this May. Just go to epicwivesexperiment.com and you can sign up. The price is insanely affordable, and we are going to do our best to overdeliver for you and to create a massive transformation in your life and in your marriage. I hope you join us. We won't be doing another one probably until fall. So this is your opportunity to get in while the getting's good. Okay, guys, I will see you in there. EpicWivesExperiment.com. Very excited to help you experience literally life-changing transformation to make your marriage as good as it possibly can be.